Paris, 1895. For quite a while now, I've been struggling with an idea of tremendous scope. At this point, I don't know if it will ever be anything more than a dream. This dream overwhelms me. It wants to push my work aside and take me over completely. It is still too soon to find out if anything real can come from my fantasy, but it is a remarkable mental creation that should be written down. Therefore, I begin this journal, which someday may prove to be the document of a dream. I have achieved success as a dramatist and a freelance writer. The Neue Freie Presse, Vienna's leading newspaper, offered me the post of Paris correspondent. I accepted. Paris, May 1895. The Neue Freie Presse assigned me to interview the famous novelist, Alphonse Daudet. We met several times after that, and on one occasion, our talk turned to the subject of Jews.
They have brought anti-Semitism upon themselves. They are greedy, garrulous, and grubbing. I myself am an anti-Semite.
You have denounced my people. Permit me to defend them. The liberals assumed that all people can be made equal simply by passing a law announcing the fact. But you must try to understand, Monsieur Daudet, that even though we are legally free of the ghetto, we still are ghetto Jews. Give us time to adjust to your world. After all, our narrow world was caused by the so-called enlightened nations of Europe. You see only the displeasing and perhaps conspicuous traits of a newly freed people. Please remember that these prisoners were unjustly punished by you.
May 30th, 1895. 14 days ago, I wrote a letter to Baron de Hirsch, who has concerned himself about the Jews in a very millionaire fashion, and most conspicuously, the Baron has agreed to see me.
Oh, you are the young man who wrote this unusual letter asking for a Jewish political conversation? Now, precisely, what does that mean?
There is one important point in the 2,000-year history of the Jewish exile that I want to bring out. In all those years, we have never had united political leadership.
What?
This has been our misfortune. The lack of leadership has done more harm than all the persecutions. If we had a united political leadership, we could proceed to the solution of the Jewish question. We could tackle it from all sides with a vigorous, determined leadership.
What a radical idea.
But that's what we need.
I have different ideas.
Your ideas were based on philanthropy. My idea is based on education and idealism. I maintain that the principle of philanthropy is mistaken. All you do is create beggars. Philanthropy undermines our people.
It is easy to be a critic. What is to be done?
Baron, Jews as a people must be uplifted. They must be made strong as for war, taught the joy of work, and the exercise of virtue.
No, 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 I do not wish to improve the general level. Jews want too much. They have ambition. This is where all our troubles come from. We have too many brains. I want to restrain the Jews from pushing ahead. Let them not make progress. Dr. Herzl, you have the whole thing backwards.
But the Baron and his ideas did have a profound effect on me. His arrogance was the stimulus I needed to crystallize my thinking. 3 weeks have passed. 3 hectic weeks of ideas that flowed from my mind like a never-ending stream. These notes are in the process of becoming a book, which will be called The Jewish State. Much of what I write is wild, fantastic. I must start sorting out my ideas or I shall go crazy. The Jewish state will be the promised land where we can have hooked noses, black or red beards, and bandy legs as we please. We can live in the Jewish state as free men on our own soil. God would not have kept us alive and separate so long if we did not have a destiny. And our destiny is a homeland.
Over here, Theo. Well, this cafe is indeed honored. The eminent correspondent of the Neue Freie Presse. Well, tell me, Dr. Herzl, are you doing a series of articles for your paper on the virtues of the sidewalk cafes of Paris?
I knew I'd find you here, Max.
Yeah, why not? They serve the best beer in town. Oh, Theo, you look like you've been wrestling with a devil.
I want to talk to you about that devil.
Now, do you wish to speak to Nordau the physician or Nordau the philosopher?
Max, for weeks I've been plagued with the pangs of a vision. I have a room full of notes, 1,000 pieces of paper torn from my brain, and all these scribblings will be a book. A book that I think will solve the Jewish tragedy.
How can you solve it with a book? Now, what is the tragedy of Jewry? That this most conservative of peoples, which yearns to root itself in a soil, has had no home for the last 2,000 years.
You understand, Max. Max, I feel that we belong together.
The philosopher Nordau understands. Now, what question have you for the physician Nordau?
Physician? Am I a maniac or am I a messiah? Being with Nordau was like a fresh drink of cool water. Although I worked as hard as ever, I took time off to talk to prominent Jews about my plan. I unfolded some of my thoughts to Dr. Moritz Goedemann, chief rabbi of Vienna. He was impressed and tried to enlist the aid of a Berlin philanthropist. I planned to visit London to meet the English writer Israel Zangwill. He has great influence with an English organization, the Maccabeans. November 22nd, 1895. In the evening with the Maccabeans. Not much of a dinner, but a good reception. The Maccabeans are educated Jews. After the meal, Zangwill, the novelist, calls on me with a tongue-in-cheek introduction. I speak in German without notes. Rabbi Singer translates what I have said every time I pause. My speech is applauded, and the Maccabeans elect me an honorary member. Since I am now a member and no longer a guest, they proceed to tear my speech apart. I refute every argument. Their real objection, as I see it, is English patriotism.
Well, welcome back to civilization.
London is civilized too, Max.
But not like Paris. Hold still while I finish my examination.
Max, I have to finish my pamphlet.
Well, you finish it in bed. Now, 3 days rest is prescribed. My friend, the London fog has given you a case of bronchial catarrh.
But, Max...
Now, you listen to my orders. After all, a prophet must have healthy lungs.
What a ludicrous picture. A prophet in a winter overcoat.
December 5th, 1895. The pamphlet is finished. What started to be a long book has been cut and recut. I've been calm and accurate in all my statements, and let us hope persuasive. Now all I need is a publisher. Vienna, December 24th. The Berlin publisher Kronbach, a Jew, refuses to publish my pamphlet. He does not agree with me. There are other publishers. January 3rd. Perhaps there are no other publishers. 2 more rejections. I could publish it myself. No. If it sells, I would look like a businessman. January 19th, 1896. At last, a publisher. Max Breitenstein. He was enthusiastic. I'm beginning to feel the relief that comes when a goal is reached. February 1st, 1896. The final proofs are ready. They already have wind of it at the office of the Neue Freie Presse. I have a new name. The staff calls me the Jewish Jules Verne. Yesterday, I was called into the editor's office.
Dr. Herzl, Your pamphlet, even before it has been published, is making quite a stir.
I know, Herr Benedict.
You are one of our most distinguished contributors. You are part and parcel of the Neue Freie Presse. At least don't put your own name to the pamphlet.
Well, that would be useless cowardice. I realize my position is at stake.
Vienna, February 15th, 1896. My Jewish state has really taken hold. I've been criticized, exorcised, or blessed, depending upon the point of view. Now I must try to implement my ideas, and the struggle will be with the world. I must meet officials in high places, and in order to see them, I must cultivate people who can gain me entry. March 16th, 1896. Yesterday I met the Reverend Hechler. He spread out a map of Palestine.
And this map is my work. You see, we have prepared the ground for you.
Very interesting.
And here in Bethel, you see, is the site for your new temple. I have chosen Bethel instead of Jerusalem because it is the center of the country. Palestine has been my enthusiasm for many years, and I have long believed in the return of the Jews to Zion. Ah, what a wonderful book you have written. Brilliant.
Thank you, Reverend. I have a problem.
Oh?
I must put myself into contact with a minister of state or a prince. Of course, the most suitable personage would be the German Kaiser. If the world sees I am backed by such a personage, the Jews will believe in me.
Dr. Herzl, it's no problem. I am ready to put on my coat this minute and go to Berlin and speak with the Emperor's pastor. You see, I used to be tutor to the Kaiser's sons, and they love me and respect me. There is only one little thing. You see, that is, I am not a rich man.
Well, neither am I, Reverend, but I'm perfectly willing to cover all your travel expenses.
It comes to several hundred florins. I can't afford it, but I'm quite willing to risk it on the chance of speaking with a Kaiser. March 17th, 1896. Dr. Beck, our family doctor, has examined me. I have weakness of the heart. I am writing to Nordau. I will assign him the job of talking to Baron de Hirsch. If Hirsch hands over a few millions, we can create a commotion in the press of the world, and the Sultan of Turkey will then receive me. Perhaps there will be some money left to win friends in Turkey. I began the letter to Nordau yesterday and finished it today. Between yesterday and today, Baron de Hirsch died. I found out an hour after I had mailed the Nordau letter. I telegraphed Nordau. What a strange affair. The pamphlet was finished months ago. I sent it to everyone except Hirsch. And as soon as I decide to do so, he dies. His death is a loss. He was the only rich Jew who did something for his poor brethren. I did not know the right way to talk to him. Our cause is poorer today. I had hoped to eventually win Hirsch over. Evening. Telegram from Hechler from Karlsruhe.
Hard work to make my wish prevail. Nevertheless, all goes well. Hechler.
Night. Hechler telegraphed again.
Come to Karlsruhe.
Strange. Baron de Hirsch is lost to us on the day I make contact with a prince.
The Jews have lost Hirsch. But they have me.
Now then, Dr. Herzl, the Grand Duke will be here in a moment. Here he comes.
Dr. Herzl, one thing I will say. Your people are highly intelligent. The kind of people one would want for the founding of your state. Tell me how you expect to accomplish this.
You see, Your Highness, What we need is for a major power to show a favorable attitude. Such an attitude would endow the society of Jews with a sort of mandate. To make my people respect the movement, we need recognition from the great powers.
Germany cannot take the first step.
Your Highness, if an experienced statesman who has helped in the creation of the German Empire, a statesman whom the Kaiser respects, were behind this new enterprise, it would make a deep impression.
Would your Royal Highness permit Dr. Herzl to inform a few trustworthy men in England that the Grand Duke of Baden has expressed interest?
I have no objection, Dr. Heckler. Gentlemen, may I suggest something? Why not first settle several hundred thousand Jews in Palestine over the next few years? When that is fait accompli, then ask for recognition.
Sir, I am opposed to sneaking them in. The Jews would be acting as rebels against the Sultan. I want to do everything within the law.
I see. I am pleased with you, Dr. Herzl. You are a man of integrity.
Thank you, Your Highness.
Dr. Herzl, I would like to see your plan come about. It will be a great blessing for many human beings.
Writing a book is complicated, but there is only one person to please, yourself. Founding a state, it seems, is much more complicated. I've been writing letters trying to explain to men such as Rothschild, Nordau, the Prime Minister of England, the Hasidim in Galicia, what we need. Turkey is our next step. Nordau has gone to London to see Rothschild. May 18th, 1896. Nordau went to Edmund de Rothschild. Rothschild will not listen. I will try to conquer Turkey without Rothschild. Constantinople is another world, and I must play the game according to their rules. There's a capable fellow, Philip Nevlinski, the son of a Polish nobleman, whom we have employed as an agent. He is brilliant and erratic. He has many contacts, and I will try to convince him to come to Constantinople with me.
I think we should forget the whole business, Dr. Herzl. The present time is all wrong in Constantinople. The Sultan will not even receive you. He has more pressing problems.
We have to make our own moments, force our own issues. I do not know what has discouraged you all of a sudden.
Well, Dr. Herzl, I will speak bluntly. You are regarded as a fanatic in journalistic circles, among people in finance and government.
The fanatics of the world get things done. A year from now, the critics will be the worshipping mob. I'm leaving tonight for Constantinople. I have friends and relatives there. I will do what I can. I hope that you will join us. We need your skill and contacts. And I cannot afford not to have an audience with the Sultan.
June 15th, 1896. I boarded the Orient Express in Vienna. Nevlinski got on in Budapest, and we talked the night through.
How much are you prepared to pay for Palestine?
20 million Turkish pounds.
Where will you get all that money?
The earth floats in midair. Perhaps similarly, I can found and stabilize the Jewish state without a firm support. This is what I hope. We will raise 20 million Turkish pounds to be used to help relieve Turkey's financial crisis. In exchange, the Sultan will give us a charter for a self-governing Jewish settlement in Palestine.
Sophia! Sophia! Watch your step getting off the train! Sophia!
A tremendous crowd had come to see me. Men, women, children were massed together. Sephardim, Ashkenazim, boys, patriarchs. A young boy handed me a wreath of roses and carnations. Someone delivered a speech in German. Someone else read out an address in French, and then kissed my hand.
Thank you, my friends. Thank you. Next year, in Jerusalem.
Dear doctor, you must understand how complicated the political life in Turkey is. In Turkey, every official is your partner. You have to allow for many commissions, but never make a direct offer.
I understand.
Your greatest asset is your press card. The Neue Freie Presse carries weight in this country, and you will find yourself admitted in high places because you are a correspondent.
At last, I've heard an optimistic remark from the ever-pessimistic Nevlinsky.
Waiter, a half bottle of champagne.
Well, that's a bad sign, Nevlinsky.
It's all off. The Sultan said to me, if Mr. Herzl is your friend, advise him to stop now. I cannot sell a foot of land. Let the Jews save their money. The Turkish people own the Turkish Empire. I am only their Sultan.
The words of the Sultan. An end to all my hopes. June 30th, 1896. On the way back, in Sofia, members of the Zionist Association met me at the station. Sensation throughout the town, I requested that a parade be dispensed with. Hundreds were awaiting me at the synagogue. I stood before the Holy Ark. I hesitated for a moment. I did not know how to face the congregation. I did not want to turn my back to the Ark.
Dr. Herzl, you may turn your back to the Ark. Your work is holy.
July 4th, 1896. I have word from the Sultan on what he wants. The next thing is to raise at least £2 million so that we may begin doing business with Turkey. I am going to London. I think perhaps the Maccabean Society and some of the rich Jews there will help. July 19th, 1896. I finally met the great Edmund de Rothschild. He is against my program, and he let me know it. After 5 minutes, I lost my manners.
You do not know what this is all about. Let me explain it to you first.
You interrupt me. I am not accustomed...
If you will permit me, Baron. You see, basically, all I wish to do is set up a big colony. I have already certain pledges from the Sultan of Turkey.
I do not believe in Turkish promises. And my dear doctor, even if I did, I would not put as much as a bent sou in your undertaking. Once you start a project such as you outline, how will you stop the influx of the masses into Palestine? At the beginning, 150,000 schnorrers would pour in, and they would expect me to feed them.
I have a suspicion that the people willing to settle in Palestine will have too much pride to take your charity. They will feed themselves.
I cannot undertake such a responsibility. There will be unfortunate incidents.
Isn't anti-Semitism one continuous unfortunate incident? Baron Edmund de Rothschild, I wanted to hand over the direction of the whole enterprise to you, the philanthropic Zionist, and eliminate myself. You are not willing. I have done my share.
July 19th, evening. I feel that Edmund is a decent, good-natured, faint-hearted fellow. This man controls the fate of millions. I will not let my ideas be stopped. I will go to the people. The day of single-handed charity is over. It's the people who will create their own funds. After thousands of years of silence, the people are about to speak.